Okay, hi.
Are you a little tired?
A little bit. Last time we did this at my house, it was really nice.
Yes.
On my porch.
You're one of the most DP's
we're
person
in the bathroom.
In the world. Well, you know, we've been slowly moving towards the bathroom.
I want to just flush it just to prove.
It's like letter.
And now I know how you feel about my movie.
Oh, now I've been a supporter of this movie from 7 years ago when it first came out at Sundance.
I know. It feels like that, doesn't it? Have you seen the new cut?
I did. I assume it was the new cut. I got one from LD. So.
Yeah. Yeah. It's different.
Yeah. It's a little tighter. But
it's tighter. It's quieter, moodier, different music.
I didn't know this was music.
The whole score is completely different.
So was that a decision you made after you sold it or after you...
After Sundance. Honestly, Sundance was such a rush to get there. And, you know, we're just... Moving. And then you get to sit there with audiences and watch it, and you're like, oh, I want to change this, I want to change that. And LD was incredibly supportive of every change I wanted to make.
So a lot of room to
do
anything
great.
You wanted to do?
Yeah.
So is it strange to have it, you know, you spend all that time making it and jamming it out to get to Sundance, and now it's been almost a year and a half.
It's like the longest gestation period.
Yeah. You beat Lake by a few months, I think.
Just barely. Just barely. On a movie that hadn't even, she was finishing the script while we were working on Black Rock.
So is it a good thing or a bad thing? I mean, it sounds like
it is what it is. Every process, I think, is a little different, and it's all about... You know, beyond just having time to finish your film, it's finding the right time of the year to open it and when, you know, so obviously we wanted to wait until Star Trek came out so we could open on the same weekend.
You were figuring you'd take on Star
Trek. Obviously, I was like, well, clearly, guys.
That's the obvious connection.
Yeah.
Well, I think the third Star Trek will be that, probably. It's just
maybe.
Six people on an island. Much cheaper. No George J.J. Abrams.
Look, J.J., I've got an idea for you.
Well, you know, they're now doing all these indie directors. They're getting all these big jobs.
I know. It's really exciting.
Yeah.
But I also think, you know, there's an appreciation for a fresh vision and, right? No?
Yes.
A little bit?
Well, it's an interesting, I mean, it's actually an ongoing conversation we keep on having about with, like, Ted Hope.
Yeah.
Who's obsessed with these things about how to kind of reinvigorate or invigorate indies.
You know, I think what we do, I think this is, it's a living, breathing beast, and I don't ever think it's going to die. I think, you know, we're creating things and we're doing things, and it will forever morph and change and turn into something else, and it's just ever evolving, and that's what art is. Art is ever evolving.
So you've taken a bit of a break? Is that part of the, because I don't see a whole lot of, I see some like small little acting credits in the last year.
Well, but I had a baby.
Yes.
So that was, you know.
The second one, which makes it even more fun.
Exactly. And, you know, we shoot The League, which takes a good 3 to 4 months out of the year. And then there was finishing Black Rock. So I feel like this entire time has been Black Rock devoted.
So it kind of worked out timing-wise.
Yeah, it's nice.
And is it good to get a little time to be a mother and a human being?
If you like kids. It's great. Honestly, I'm really sort of loving our balance of, like, you know, you work, you play. Mm-hmm. The girls are getting, you know, we've created a family and they play with each other now. It's so fun. It's really, it's super special.
So you just feel like you guys are growing up?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, honestly, there's also, you know, I have to, you know, balance Mark's career as well, and he is at a peak right now, and that's just how it works. And, you know, when those offers come in, you don't know if they're going to keep coming in, so you have to say yes. And so he is, like, hitting his stride here, and so, you know, I balance it over here, and then it will go like this and like this.
So you're like the Eddie Fisher and... Well, not Eddie Fisher, because he kept on getting divorced.
Yeah, I don't think...
What's the appropriate couple? Who couple lasted a long time in Hollywood?
We're Goldie and Kurt.
You're Goldie and Kurt.
We're married and we wear clothes.
You guys actually wear clothes around the house?
We do.
See, I assume people would just assume that you guys are just walk around the house.
I know, but we've got all these windows. No, I just like to walk around the woods with my clothes.
A strong choice in the middle of the movie.
I
managed to completely forget about it before I saw it again.
That's sort of how it goes, though, isn't it? It's like, because, you know, this is a common question that is brought up in interviews and press. But I do find it really interesting. I think within, like, there's the initial shock of, like, oh my God, they're naked. And then the next thing you know, you're fully enveloped in the scene and the story again, because I think, you know, at that point it's like minute 50 and, you know, you're on board with those characters. And so because it's not, you know, a sexual type of story, I think because it is a survival, you are behind them and you are with them. And,
well, just, it creates an intimacy at that moment that's so intense.
And a vulnerability, really. And they feel just so small in the woods and so small. So small. That's all I can think of. It's like they're the squirrels.
So when Mark gave you those pages initially, did you go, what are you doing?
I was like, so clearly you want me to play Sarah, right? And he was like, what? No, Abby. And I was like, but she gets naked. And he's like, I know. We're going to have to talk about that.
So is that how it is? Is it a long conversation? I mean, how do you guys work as writer?
A conversation.
A writer and director, though, how is it?
You know, honestly, it's a really nice collaboration because what's so cool is like this is very different than a movie that he would make, you know. Right. So we do get to have that push and pull of you know, telling the story that I want to tell and him structuring it the way he wants to structure it. And then, you know, at the same time, he doesn't have the, you know, because we are working so closely together, he's very comfortable handing the script to me and saying, no, do a dialogue pass, go for it. I want you to be really comfortable with the dialogue. Where some writers are like, no, that is my script.
So you never have to throw him off set? You know?
Yeah, no, well, I mean, I throw him off set just because I could.
Just to get that power.
Just because I could.
So are you anxious to direct again? It's been a while.
Yeah, I'll definitely, I will. I'm anxious to do it all again. I love acting in other people's projects because it's less responsibility and and you know, when you come off of a project that has been years in the making, you're like, please let it be someone else's problem for just a minute. So it's a little bit like childbirth in that way. Like, I think I need a little bit of space. I need Black Rock to go out into theaters and I need to like cleanse myself of the process a little bit. And but I'm definitely, there's things percolating.
So you're still in it even though it's been a long time.
Oh, I'm so in it. I mean, it's so much a part of my day to day. It's so crazy. In a way that Freebie was very fast and furious and like the next thing I knew, it was gone and out the door. And you know, it's like, you know, we did Sundance and I think it released, I remember, I want to say in the spring. So it was very quick. This is years later.
So is that good or bad? Which one's better? Is there one better?
No, it's, you know, different. Every project is different. And also I'm learning so much along the way. So I've learned to speak up and say, you know, there are changes I want to make. And and I was so lucky that I was able to make them, but it made my editorial process that much longer. You know, it's not an easy feat to rescore a movie.
So when do you actually let go of this one? When it opens or when the DVD comes out?
I think so, because we are opening theatrically and on VOD. I think there's no like measuring the box office, because that is the defining factor. It's such a different way of releasing a movie and gauging your success. I think it's going to be a much slower slower climb.
Defining factor for you? I mean, are you like going to sit there and look at numbers and go,
I will totally do that. I would love to say that I won't do that, but I'm going to do that. Because I'm curious. I think that this, for me, this is an interesting movie and I am interested. I would be, as an audience member, very interested in it. I'm curious to see if other audiences feel the same way. You know? I don't know.
But it's always interesting because it's never like just a straight thing of, because they haven't seen the movie. You know, like you said, you're going in Star Trek, so it's kind of like, it's hard to get a real
It's handle. Hard to get a gauge. And honestly, now that it is available to everyone, anyone, Timbuktu can go, you know, get onto iTunes and buy this movie.
Do they have the Timbuktu market? Is that
I'm covering? Huge in Timbuktu. I can't walk the streets.
You're number one in Timbuktu.
I cannot walk the streets in Timbuktu.
It's like Van Damme is still number one in somewhere in the South Pacific.
Oh, I know.
He has islands that are his.
Of course he is.
It's a little surreal.
I mean, give it to him.
So that's all you really wanted was Timbuktu, and now you can retire happily onto your island.
Yeah, I'm going to buy my island.
They'll build a statue of you at the airport. I think it'd be very cool.
I think so. I'm so curious. You're always curious.
So did you do the DVD extras and everything with the girls already? Is that
we
already
did.
Like locked in?
We have done like, you know, yes. We did a very ranty, rambly commentary that is either going to be the best or worst commentary. Because the thing is we truly are friends. Mm-hmm. And so it's Lake and I on the commentary, and we will sit there and just play off each other all day long. And, like, there doesn't have to be anyone in the room.
Would you listen to commentaries yourself normally?
I don't. I used to, I think, when I had more time. And now I don't. I'm lucky if I get to see an entire movie.
Yeah.
I know.
Without being interrupted.
Without falling asleep.
Yeah.
Because I am so tired all the time.
So you probably would not listen to your own commentary if you...
No. I don't think I listen to my commentary on the freebie. I don't like the sound of my voice.
Is that the thing? Is that, like, some actresses don't like their chin or their nose, whatever?
Yeah, it's my voice. I don't like it.
Because it's...
I don't like it.
You don't like
it. I'm
voice.
Going to say that as interesting.
You can turn into
possible.
Eartha Kitt.
I know. It's all right. I'm not going to learn anything from myself.
That's true.
Isn't that the point of a commentary?
But it must be kind of like looking back through a yearbook or through...
Maybe. Maybe I'll revisit it in the years to come when I want to get...
When you've made your 20th film, you'll...
Exactly.
Go back to this one.
Be like, God, I was an idiot.
Do you look back now 5 years and 10 years and think you're an idiot, or...
No. Like, I look back at, like, Freebie, and I love that movie so much. Like, I'm really... That was such a really special experience, and I'm so proud of what we made. And... You know, we came out of Black Rock, and I was like, that was the hardest thing. Like, I think when I saw you at Sundance, I was like, this movie kicked the shit out of us, and I'm never going to make another movie again. And, you know, you do. You get time, and you get space, and you the painful stuff starts to sort of disappear, and what you remember are the really special moments, like the scene in the fort. That is, as a filmmaker and an actor... You know, those are moments that you strive to achieve and that sometimes you never do and you never get that chance. And then when that happens, that is such a win for you. I think there are other things. I look back at, like, interviews and I'm like, oh, God, Kitty, you think you're so flipping cute. And you're not. Like, you're
and you
not.
Get paid by people to be cute. That's part of your thing.
I know.
And someday... You'll be older.
I know. And it'll be someday, like, I won't be so cute.
Yeah. Well, you'll be cute differently.
Maybe.
You'll be grown-up cute.
Someday.
Someday.
Maybe. This is my very grown-up outfit.
It is a very grown... I was expecting you to do a tap number coming in.
My lady outfit.
I don't know if the audience can actually see your legs, but it's a very impressive display.
Thank you.
So, I mean, a shot like the fort scene, did how you chose to shoot that... just come naturally? Did that was just an impulsive thing, or was that...
I had an idea of what I wanted it to look like, and Hilary Spira, my DP, has just a beautiful eye. She really shoots such beautiful images. And we really sort of came together and I loved the idea of, like, the moonlight just sort of cresting the face and it being sort of in shadows, and the lighting just... Wyatt Garfield was our gaffer, and he nailed it perfectly. It was, like, exactly what we wanted, this very soft glow. And so visually, when I looked at the frame, I was like, that is great. Now we have to make this scene work. Because it's a tricky... That scene on paper is tricky. I think you have to sort of hit emotional notes that if they ring false, like, the scene is ruined, you know? It was hard. And, you know, we didn't hit it in every take.
So do you, I mean, in terms of the look of it, to start with, I mean, have you written down 300 notes? Have you written down four notes? Have you just had a conversation or two? Or
lots of conversation, some notes, a lot of thought. And a lot of, we went through books of photography of, like, you know, these are images. And honestly, there is something really beautiful about shooting in nature that I had never experienced before. Freebie was mostly interior stuff. And to only just put a small light somewhere, and which we could do, we were shooting on the Arri Alexa, which is such an amazing camera in those situations, and it captures so much with so little. It was very cool. We were literally in the middle of the woods with, like, one tiny little light, and it created just this lovely glow.
So do you consider yourself a... improvisational director of some level, or do you...
No, but I am a go-with-the-flow director, because you honestly, that was the one thing we really learned shooting all outside, is, like, you can have an idea of what you want that shot to be, but when you're on a cliff, like, right. there's only so many places a camera can go, mm-hmm. you know? And we really, we were challenged by, you know, super short nights. We were shooting on the shortest nights of the year mm-hmm. on the tip of the East Coast, where the light would change at 3:15 in the morning.
Which you knew, or somebody had to get fired over this?
No, I mean, I should have known. This was my hometown. I was born and raised here. Things that you don't think about. When you see, you know, sunrise, sunset, that doesn't necessarily mean when the light starts to change.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Like, and when you're shooting east, you see the light changing.
Yeah.
You know, tides. What call sheet have you ever seen where you have the entire tidal chart for the day?
Like Waterworld, probably.
Yeah, I mean, that was all on a set. Come on. But, like, we scouted locations, found everything. We went back for pre-production, like, you know, a month before we started mm-hmm. shooting. I wanted to double-check locations. I wanted to walk it with Hillary.
Mm-hmm.
We show up, one location, 12 feet underwater. Gone.
Yeah.
There was, like, it wasn't even like we were standing in a foot of water. It was, like, over our heads, mm-hmm. gone. There was no location. So, you know, there was, you could have ideas of what you wanted things to be, but you mm-hmm. couldn't hold on to them too tight. Like you could when you're in a room that's pre-lit and you know exactly what you're gonna get. We never knew exactly. And right. you know, if the fog came in, it changed our lighting completely. It was okay. interesting. It was, so yeah, for this film, I was very improvisational.
Well, what makes you feel any better, Waterworld, which had a slightly bit larger budget than your film, even back then.
Wasn't that
an was they shot in Hawaii.
Did they?
They kind of insisted on shooting Hawaii, and they had the same exact problem where they had kind of shot, prepped everything for certain kind of weather,
yeah.
and the weather shifted, and that's why they went so massively over budget. And
yeah.
the great part was because just they couldn't do the things physically, the world changed. And they wanted it to look real, so they were on the ocean, but they picked the wrong place at the wrong time.
And that just happens, because
yeah.
you are outside, and you it is the only thing you cannot control.
But you were probably missing, you know, $95 million or so of budget to cover.
I was. Yeah, I didn't kickstart that.
Wasn't quite as easy.
So
how does that affect your editing?
It was tricky. I mean, we still managed to, you know, we would get to the location ahead of time, and mm-hmm. we would sort of do a quick rundown of exactly what we're going to do. So we knew what we were going to walk away with. It was never like, there was never a moment that I can think of in the middle of shooting where it's like, oh, fuck, we're not going to get that
right.
shot that I thought we were going to get. We always made adjustments. So I knew what I was walking away with, which was nice. So, but for the edit, I think the trickiest thing was like, you know, it's rainy and cloudy in one scene, and in the other scene, you know, in the other direction, it's sunny, because
mm-hmm.
that's just how our weather went. And you just gotta roll with it and hope you can adjust it enough in color that no one is going to notice.
You sound like this happened 3 weeks ago.
Really?
It's really funny, because I've talked to a lot of directors.
I feel like I've really been living with it.
Yeah.
Like, there was something about going back in and recutting it that was, it was a long, you know,
it's like meeting an old friend.
Exactly.
And taking all of its clothes off and reassembling it.
I know what that's
cutting
all
it up.
About.
But yeah, I mean, I talk to a lot of directors who, you know, they're 6 months out or 2 months out or whatever, and there's a little more distance. It sounds like you know, you're still in the moment of each shot, it sounds like.
Yeah, it's all very clear to me. Like, I have very vivid memories about all of it, because it was intense. It was unlike anything I had ever experienced before.
So has the universe of indie film for you changed much in the last... in the process of these two films, and now another couple years after that?
Yeah, you know, there are a lot more famous people in our world now. You know what I mean? Like, I think...
You mean like Zach Braff?
Oh, Zach.
Well, this is a Kickstarter film.
Yeah, well...
One of the early Kickstarter films.
Well, that's
films.
Kind of, I think, the thing. It's interesting to compare the two, because we kickstarted our camera package, like just one small mm-hmm. aspect, because we had budgeted for one camera
mm-hmm.
and realized as we were going through our prep how amazing it would be to have an Arri Alexa.
Mm-hmm.
At the time, I don't know what they're renting for now, but at the time, those packages are like insanely expensive.
Mm-hmm.
We got an incredible deal from Boston Camera, and it was still like 10 times more
mm-hmm.
than what we would have paid for other camera. We paid for the rest of the film ourselves. And, you know, $20,000, $25,000 at that point was like, kind of pushed us a little out of our comfort zone. Mm-hmm. We were like, you know what? Let's crowdsource it. I love the idea of Kickstarter. I actually think it's really great. I don't necessarily agree with the direction it's going now mm-hmm. with, you know, Veronica Mars and
Studio
and
Zach.
Yeah, I think that's really a little messed up.
Yeah.
But I do think there's something really special about audiences being able to invest from the beginning and getting a part of something and mm-hmm. being a part of something, you know, and getting something special for it. Like, one of my favorite rewards for our Kickstarter campaign was that everyone got the island that we shot on.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually called Flint Island, mm-hmm. and because it's made of flint. But the water hacks away at the stone and breaks off for some reason, the rock breaks off almost in L-shaped pieces.
Mm.
But then when it gets weather-beaten and beaten by the waves in the ocean, they shine up and soften into these little heart-shaped rocks. Mm. And so everyone got, like, a little black rock from mm-hmm. our movie. And that's really special. Like, that's... And, you know, for, like, $20 or something.
Right.
You know, and it's not a lot of money, and it's... And it's a way to be a part of something and get updates on mm-hmm. on people whose movies you like to watch, or even League fans are like, oh, cool, you're doing this. It's so different than what you do. I don't know how I feel about studios. I feel like studios get more and more scared, and this is a way of dealing with their fear of investing money in a movie.
Yeah.
It's like, no, okay, you guys say you want to see it, put up your money first. Before I put up my money, you put mm-hmm. up your money. And I think that's just kind of gross.
Yeah. Well, kind of like the Veronica Mars thing. I think it was all well-intended, and obviously we're trying to get money for a long time. But once you have this kind of outpouring of support, you would think they just, like, back up the truck and say, okay,
and
now let,
like,
the studio
okay,
pay for
that's
it.
That's cool.
Thank you all. You get a free ticket or
what an
free
amazing,
DVD or
yeah,
whatever.
What an amazing show, sign of,
yeah.
like, solidarity.
But we're not taking your $4 million.
No, they're absolutely going to take it, yeah. and they're going to spend it, and they're probably going to ask for more.
Yeah, no doubt.
You know, and, you know, can Zach Braff probably get financing for his movie? Probably.
Yeah.
Sorry, Zach, but you probably can get financing. Garden State did okay.
Yeah. So we won't be seeing any Duplass Brothers movies going into the $6 million Kickstarter campaign anytime soon.
No, I'm going to ask someone very specifically for $6 million of their own money.
You can give me your money and give
yeah,
it to me now.
Exactly.
It makes perfect sense.
And because that's what they do. They're financiers.
So do you feel like this is a interesting, happy place for films to be in terms
always.
Of the VOD,
I mean,
release
yeah.
concept?
I think it's, you know, we're kind of at the place that we were... Or at a similar place when the cameras started changing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all of a sudden things became more accessible for filmmakers, and now things are becoming more accessible for audiences. I think it's amazing that Timbuktu can see Black Rock.
Right.
Timbuktu could not see the freebie. You know, we didn't do a VOD thing
mm-hmm.
Directly. And that's great. And they're doing it in a way that it's, you know, financially, it's a model that works for everyone. You know, it's making movies available, and it's at the same time, you know, it is, you know, working on the financial model on the marketing side for the movie as well. And
did you ever have any vanity about, I need to be on a big screen, I need to, you know?
Mm-hmm. Of course. I'm not going to lie. You never make
you
a
can mo- lie if you,
you
want
never
to.
Make a movie with the intention of it being seen on a television.
Yeah.
I love a theater going experience. I think it's something, there's something very special watching a movie with an audience. I think Black Rock in particular is a very fun movie to watch with an audience. It's
yeah.
a very different movie than watching it by yourself. Probably fun to watch by yourself as well, but really fun to watch with an audience.
Yeah.
'Cause there's moments, you know, and that's that kind of energy, I think, infuses your experience. And
what is it? It's a different kind of thriller.
Yeah.
And the thriller market has gotten so violent. And there's, I mean, it's almost like it's so much away from that, because there is violence in the movie, but it's not gory.
It's not excessive.
You know,
it's not indulgent, in my opinion. I don't think it's indulgent.
But it's an interesting marketing proposition to, like, say, okay, this is a thriller, but not a horror movie, but not a, you know, it's like, there are all these, one of the reasons the movie's so interesting and so enjoyable to watch is because it's so many things you don't necessarily expect put together.
Yeah, well, good. Thank you. I mean, that was sort of the point, was to go back to the more classic thrillers that
yeah.
are really character-driven and story-driven and reality-based and simple.
Well, I remember
there's
that
no,
scene.
You know, albinos in a crevasse. Why would they be there? Why the heck is black goo dripping out of my air conditioning vent? Like, why is hair coming up out of the tub? Like, that's so weird and grossly terrifying,
yes.
But I don't actually worry about that ever happening. And I never wonder what I would do if black, I mean, maybe I have wondered what I would do if black hair grew up out of my drink. But for me,
in
it's
certain
very,
places in Los Angeles, it might actually happen.
I know. For me, I think it's a much more interesting creative venture to create something that would make an audience wonder what they would do in that scenario and with relatable characters mm-hmm. In a situation that they could horribly see themselves falling into. That is something I and you know also working off of you know dynamics between you know two characters that have a weird history together.
Yeah.
I love that.
Well, it's interesting because I just actually was having the conversation about Matilda on Broadway now, which is a Roald Dahl book, and it's a fantastic
show. My daughter loves the movie.
Well, the show is stunning.
Cool.
It's really one of the great shows.
Oh, I should take.
But it feels like the next generation of Annie. It feels like you know if a kid today
really
were to
dark.
Tell that story.
It's so dark.
But it's smart. The kids are more conscious. They're not just kind of smiling and tap dancing. They're,
Yeah.
I mean, they're like real kids mm-hmm. more. And in some ways, Black Rock feels like that. It's not, you know, you have nudity in it. You have more real violence, but you also have kind of the old-fashioned noir-y stuff going on as well. It's not, it's an interesting, it feels like a step.
Good.
As opposed to a whole new.
Well, maybe I'm changing the world.
You could be.
Maybe.
You never know when the world's going to change. It's kind of a funny thing.
It's true.
It sneaks up behind you and then hits you over the head.
Yeah, we'll see. Fingers crossed.
So
but yeah, if we could move away from torture porn, I'd be pretty happy about
it. Well, thank God that Eli Roth got a show on Netflix. He loves it, clearly. His
Great.
Twitter keeps on saying so. So do you feel like... So will $6 million be your next movie? Is that where you're thinking? Or $12
million? Gosh, that would be a nice place to live. That's a lot more money than I've ever played with before. I would like to make a movie where we have more time to shoot. It's getting very exhausting to like blast through a very fast schedule.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say, you know, Freebie was a 12-day shoot and...
That must seem like a lifetime ago at this point, in terms of...
I was like a child.
Like, 12-day shoot.
I know. But it felt like all the time in the world we needed.
Mm-hmm.
Black Rock was a much more, you know, challenging movie to make in so many ways. And that movie could have easily been a 2 or 3 month movie that we jammed into less mm-hmm. than one, so...
So is it like more like I'm a grown-up now and I need a few more days to actually breathe and let things settle?
No...
Or?
Well, okay. Regarding the schedule, it's not even that. It's more of just like, I feel like we sort of plow through mm-hmm. to plow through. And I feel like we make mistakes and we lose things in that process. Like, I want to sort mm-hmm. of slow down and really just slow down a little bit. But as far as, you know, making, you know, a more expensive movie, I also feel like I'm ready as a filmmaker to make, you know,
mm-hmm.
for a long time, I was like, no, I'll make mistakes on my own dime. You know,
mm-hmm.
when I've got to figure this out and it's on me and I'm not going to play with someone else's money. I also don't want someone barking down my neck about
right.
the things that they, you know, as I'm trying to learn what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I want anyone barking down my neck now, but I am confident enough in my abilities as a filmmaker and a storyteller.
And how about as a woman filmmaker? Do you feel like a woman filmmaker?
Well, I am a woman filmmaker, so yeah.
Technically.
Yes, I do. Man, you make me feel like a woman. Filmmaker. I get this a lot of like, you know, what's it like to, why are there no more women filmmakers?
Mm-hmm.
Where I think, I can't speak to it personally, because personally, I have never run into the speed bumps of you know, having doors closed in my face because I'm a woman.
Because
mm-hmm. I've made my own movies. So for women who feel like they are having doors closed in their faces, I say the Freebie was in the can for $10,000. It got to Sundance for $15,000. That's not a crazy amount of money.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something worth kickstarting. That is something worth kickstarting. So make a movie.
So that is really the ultimate advice, isn't it? It's like, I mean,
yeah.
Every time I talk to a woman filmmaker about, you know, all this talk about women filmmakers, it's often like, well, you know, I'm too busy working to have that conversation.
I am a woman who likes to make movies, and when I have a chance to make them, I make them. I just, you know, and I think that's how men work as well, as far as I can tell.
Mm-hmm.
They have penises and we have vaginas, and that's how it works out.
Well, I think there's slightly more interest from the guys in breaking things and smashing things.
And
that's
look,
attractive studios.
Is there, you know, a huge disparity between female and male filmmakers in the thriller and horror genre? Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Because, and I don't know if that is, it's a gender thing per se, but, you know, or a sensibility thing or, you know, or what, but yeah, but that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
There's also, you know, that's okay.
What's interesting is like Kathryn Bigelow, who is, you know, both very talented and been mostly successful, makes boys films.
Yeah.
Almost exclusively. She's really never made, she made one film that really could be considered at all a female, you know, led film, which is...
With Zero Dark?
No, I don't think, well, Zero Dark is, though I don't think the perception is that I don't necessarily...
What would you say was a female film?
The one with Jamie Lee Curtis, Blue Steel.
Oh, okay.
Years ago.
Right. I haven't seen that.
Yeah.
But, I, you
but
know,
Zero
I think,
actually is that without anybody ever acknowledging it. It was kind of amazingly penis-oriented.
You tell the stories you want to tell.
Mm-hmm.
And that isn't a feminist thing. It's, you know, if you feel the need to tell those stories, tell those stories. Absolutely. If you want to tell the story of Point Break, which I would love to retell, I know, tell that story. Tell the story that you feel like you can tell. That's how you're going to make a good movie. Don't tell a story because you feel like you have to tell it.
So what's the draw to Point Break, the masks or the surfing?
I think Patrick Swayze's performance in that movie is one of the more underrated performances.
Keanu's actually really good in it also. I mean, he's like...
I will say he's decent. Rewatch it and hey! Hi, Lakers! Lake Bell, everyone.
Hey, Fred Melamed.
Can you see her in the mirror?
Can we see her in the
happen?
Mirror? She sticks her head in the right place.
Yeah, I think, you know, Patrick Swayze, that's a tricky role. It's a trap role. Mm-hmm. And I think he does really special stuff with it. I would also recommend you go back and rewatch Roadhouse.
Roadhouse is a genius movie for what it is. I mean,
it's
that's what it is.
It's a great movie.
And Sam Elliott. And
he is a talented actor.
Yeah.
Was. May he rest in peace.
Yeah.
I feel like he never fully got recognized for his talents. I'm gonna throw that out there.
Well, when you're a genre act, you know, when you're either dancing or hitting, it's hard to get much
and
recognition.
And when you're dancing and hitting well.
Yeah. Not
it
everybody
distracts.
Can do that.
It distracts from your performance.
He's very big in Timbuktu.
Is he?
So
our
Timbuktu.
Could our statues be side?
You could be next to each other, yes. We'll put you at the airport together.
Dreams coming true.
So do you have a complete range of films that you are interested in? I mean, if you're watching Roadhouse and falling in love with that, it doesn't sound like you have too many limitations on what
I
you're
don't.
Interested in.
I really, you know, give me a good story and I'm in. I'm always a sucker for like a good nostalgic sports movie. Love those. Mm. Love those. Give me a great documentary, in. Rom-com, if it's, you know, if it grabs me,
mm-hmm.
I'm there. I really don't like torture porn. I would say that's probably the only genre I don't gravitate toward.
Foreign?
I like them if I am not tired, but my eyes get really,
watching.
You know,
yeah.
Reading and I, but I just, I like movies. I've always liked movies.
Was there a film or films that particularly inspired? I mean, obviously, Mark wrote it, so...
Yeah, I mean, Deliverance, too. I think, would be the most, you know, specific touchstone for the movie. But I've been referencing River Wild a lot lately because mm-hmm. I love that she's just Meryl... I mean, first off, she's Meryl Streep. Second off, I love that she's just a mom in mom jeans and is put in this extraordinary situation of having to save her family.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that. I love that.
Mm.
Love that movie. I talked Curtis Hanson's ear off one night about that movie. I was like, I know people talk to you about LA Confidential. I know that. But this is where we're going. He was lovely.
He's a nice guy.
He's a really sweet guy. And Doc, that's like another one with like a really cool mm-hmm. span of movies. I like that. I think that's what you get from someone who likes a lot of movies. You get, you know, someone who can't pick their major in college.
Well, you have auteurs who have like one story to tell, and they tell that a lot and often and really well. And you have, you know, filmmakers, directors who just direct.
Exactly.
So people creeping around behind.
I know.
Really exciting.
David.
We gotta get her to the kid.
David.
So would you consider yourself one, or I guess you would consider yourself more somebody who is a director, just wants to.
I'm still finding my voice and still finding the stories I want to tell. But like I said, I think you have to be attracted to the story, and whether that is about, you know, a guy working the door at a roadhouse, or someone, you know, dismantling bombs in Afghanistan, or if that is three girls on an island, if it's a story that you want to tell, you have to tell that story.
And does the size of the machinery on some of that stuff intimidate you, or do you just kind of figure it's more of the same and you can wrap
it up? Yeah, totally. Like, you know, I haven't really blown anything up yet, so I'm intimidated by that. I probably won't do that anytime soon.
So you go from 6 to 12 to 227.
Yeah. I'll emotionally blow someone up instead.
And does all the parenting have much effect on your work, or are they really different hats?
No, it does. I think it makes me really appreciate what fierce loyalty, like, and then the passion and the, you know, I understand myself a lot more, I think, as a person and an artist, and what drives me.
I'm getting poked repeatedly.
I know, you really are.
I know. It's like being a director. You have to, somebody has to poke you and tell you it's time.
Yeah.
The lights are actually set.
Moving on.
Okie doke.
That's a wrap.